Blackstone Publishing presents End of the Ocean by Matthew McBride. This book is read by Keith Szarabajka.
For her. The first and final thing you have to do in this world is to last it and not be smashed by it. Ernest Hemingway. Buy the ticket, take the ride. Hunter S. Thompson. Rainy season. Rings of thick white froth carried on saltwater waves blew through the air and became mist that sprayed his shirtless back as he, sitting in a low-slung chair, took in all he saw and heard. The people and the sand and the ocean and the waves. And as he sat there, content for the first time in as long as he could remember, he recognized the beauty of that moment, that never in his life would he know such splendor in a sunset as he saw that first night in Bali, alone, watching and thinking beside a small wooden hut on a white sand beach by a green-blue sea that would soon become his home. Waves smashed sandbanks and birds of various shape and size walked the beach beside him and flew above him, floating in gusts of wind that lifted from the swells in great bursts of sea salt foam. Sage had a lot of work to do. Figuring out his life and adjusting to the decision he'd made that brought him there. A decision he still, even now, could not believe he had made. Moving to Indonesia to find himself. Or to lose himself. Whichever came first. To leave everything he had ever known for a world he could not have imagined. It was very warm in the evening shade, well veiled by a burnt orange umbrella attached to a bamboo stick driven into pallid sand that was twice the size of the umbrella they once owned, still in the backyard of their former house, which she now owned, free and clear, which she shared with her new husband and his three kids and their two dogs, his and Bailey's, the dogs she had also kept, along with the umbrella and the table it was attached to, from the marriage which ended 6 months ago when Sage was still her legal husband. Before she cheated on him and left him for a man she'd just met and barely knew. He opened a bottle of Bentang and took the first drink and swallowed hard. He'd expected the beer to be bad, but it was worse than he'd expected. He set the bottle on the wooden table. It was a table hand-cut from sandalwood, lacquered with oil and covered in a glistening sheen. It had been a long trip from the States. 16 hours sitting in an upright position next to a man who the entire flight farted and drank beer and ate peanuts. His name was Wayne Tender. He was tall and bony with a sharp nose and a dimpled chin, with black hair slicked back in thin strips until it disappeared behind his head. He was a consultant from Australia, and Sage hated him for the first 10 hours, but those last 4 or 5 had been okay. Because Sage started drinking after that, and even that late in the game, Sage made a valiant effort to put as much distance as he could between his first drink and his last. It would be a strange journey, of this Sage was convinced. Turned out Wayne Tender had been a professional boxer when he was a younger man. That's what he'd said. His record, 16-1. 4 by draw and 11 by knockout, except he told Sage they'd been knocked the fuck out, driving one bony-knuckled fist into the palm of his other hand to better demonstrate the effectiveness of his punch. "I even broke a man's orbital once," he said, pointing to his cheekbone. "Ever do that, mate?" Sage said he hadn't. He'd been in a fight or two in his time, given a black eye or two in his day, and he'd taken a few as well, but he'd never broken anyone's orbital. "All goes black soon as it happens." Wayne snapped his fingers and nodded, then took a drink, going on to regale Sage with further stories of badassery and brutality, all of which had captivated Sage and forced him to pay attention. Wayne was a strange one, but he was also Australian, though according to him, he'd actually grown up in England, which could explain it. Sage had never met an Englishman, or an Australian. Maybe they all drank beer and told stories and farted freely among strangers. Sage had a lot to learn about people. "I had to stab this bloke in the back, I did," Wayne said. He'd gone on to tell Sage it was a matter of self-defense. "He was coming at me," Wayne said. Though hours after their plane had landed, Sage still wondered how Wayne could have stabbed a bloke in the back who'd been coming at him. Remembering the flight, Sage leaned back in his chair on the beach and got comfortable, took another drink of beer. Still as bad as it was the first time, but he'd been assured.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.